Hey guys, we're going to be upgrading our garage floor coating. So those of you that follow the channel or have been watching our garage series know that we've been developing our new YouTube studio, which is also our home shop. So to save money, we did a grind and seal. I didn't mind seeing the cracks. Now keep in mind, the way concrete cures, especially when it's this thick, it's insulated, you're going to get cracking. It's just inherent. So this is actually 8 inches thick on this side. It's about 6 roughly over here, probably close to 8, but we had to make it thicker, minimum 6 for the hoist, but we wanted to overkill it just a little bit, and obviously it's reinforced with the rebar. So we have cracks in it, but to save on money, I opted not to do the flake. So we used a cheaper material, and we started to come across the limitations of the product fairly quickly within the first year. So if you're doing epoxy, you can see these scratches here. That's from a motorcycle kickstand. It does scratch easy on light things, like even the garbage can here, we move it out a lot. So we can see there are a bunch of scratches there. Nothing wrong with the workmanship. That's just the limitations of the product. Kind of was expecting it to do that. What I wasn't expecting was some of the damage here, and you can see it's lifting where I park. So what I think was happening was when I would come home in the summertime, tires are really hot, more sticky. It starts to pick off the material. You see the tread there, and it's doing the exact same thing on this side over here. So this was all going to be covered under warranty. So we decided to make a deal like, hey, if you're going to cover this under warranty, we might as well go ahead and flake it. Because the other limitation that I have with grind and seal is it absorbs quite a bit of light. I thought because it was shiny, it would reflect really well off of here, and it's not. And the reason why I know that is outside, what we did was we had bare concrete out here before. Then we did a grind and seal, and the light just does not reflect that off that well at all. And you know, this works really well. This is the poly and it has really good grip, but we're actually gonna end up flaking it similar to the patio over here. It's a big learning process for us because you don't know how it's gonna look and work till you're done. So what we're hoping to see is we're gonna see a lot more reflective light. Obviously with the flake, it's gonna cover up all our cracks and everything, so that's all gonna go away. So what we're gonna show you in this video, guys, is a couple of the key things, what it takes to flake the floor. I will say you can drop tools on it, but if we hit it with a corner, it's not gonna like it. So you see there's one. So if it lands flat, it can take it, but coming down like this would be another limitation. So that's where you might not want to do epoxy. I would say if you want to do epoxy, you're usually just using your garage, like you're just driving in, or maybe you're trying to set up the house for a quicker sale. You kind of have like, you know, we have a limited lifespan in the garage and you're not using it that harshly. This is a perfect product because of the price point it comes at. If you're someone like me, you're going to be in here long term, it's going to get worked pretty hard, then you have to go with the tougher stuff. I also recommend coating your floor with anything, whether it be garage floor paint, epoxy, poly with the flake, or grind and seal, because if you ever spill anything on it, I'm just not a fan of oil stains soaking into concrete. It just doesn't look good over time. And when you coat it, it's just so easy to clean up afterwards. Usually what I do here is I'll wipe it up. You might have some residue. It might still be slippery if it's like motor oil. Just take some brake clean and then wipe it up again. And then your floor just looks the same after. So we have Manny and Jazz here from Cal's Epoxy. And they originally did the job. So Manny, right now, what are you doing to the floor?
We're just sanding it down just so we can reopen the pores. It gives it a cleaner surface for our next product to bond to.
Okay, and if this is bare concrete, what else would you be doing to it?
We'd be diamond grinding it with our machines, and it'd be fully like ground.
So just like anything, prep is everything for this product to work properly and last long.
Yeah, all right. Prep's always 100% like the main key. And the more time you take on prep, the better, the longer your product will last. That's with anything. So.
So right now we're doing the coating. So you can see this is how they do it. They have special footwear. It's basically like a giant slipper with spikes on it. And this allows them to walk all over the shop. So they can't actually paint themselves into a corner. They can walk wherever they need to. And you can see that they've sealed and filled the cracks. So when our coating goes on with the polyurea and the flake, it'll all get hidden. I think that's the only way to get a good, perfect looking floor is you have to do something similar to this. You have to fill the cracks. As cool as grind and seal looks, this is gonna look a lot cleaner, a lot more uniform. So what's interesting is when you have an experienced and trained technician do the job, you can see that there's minimal, if no, masking. The reason why they don't mask is they found with the polyurea, what it does is it'll actually creep underneath the tape. So what they have to do to compensate is just take their time. They can remove some over coating if they need to, if they catch it quickly enough, but experience is key to having this done. So why should we pay a professional versus maybe a do-it-yourself kit? Because you can buy those and that's totally cool if you want to. Well, these guys are equipped to take on pretty much any task. We see that they have the coating done in their trailer, one, because it works, and it's also a good selling feature. Like how durable is this? Because, you know, you're rolling tools in and out all the time, it's subjected to the elements. It's a pretty harsh environment for a trailer compared to, let's say, like a showroom floor. If it's in a garage, obviously it's even more harsh because you're dealing with more weight. But we can see they bring their own generator, so they don't have to worry about power in case there's an outage, or maybe you're in a new build, you don't have power yet. And we can see that they have a lot of material in means of surface prep and putting all the material together and mixing it. So do you want to get the best result possible? It's probably worth spending the extra couple grand, especially if you're gonna be in your home for a long time. Yeah, you might save some money, but if you're gonna have to redo your garage floor like we are right now, it's actually more costly because you have to move things around. And even with my toolboxes are staying in there. That means we can't coat everything underneath. So if I really want it to be uniform all the way, I have to wait for this part to be done, then move the toolboxes, and then coat again. So time is a huge thing. If you can get a pro to coat your surface all in one shot off the beginning, it's well worth the money. So I have to wait 7 days for that coating to cure before we can do our test. So here we are on the trailer. This is the same wrench, so we'll just do the same test. And then let's do our drop test. It's significantly tougher. And the nice thing too is because it's an imperfect finish, even if you were to chip it a little bit, it's very hard to detect. If you have something that's super uniform, it's obviously easier to detect any kind of imperfection. So here's an interesting thing I noticed is I'm watching the team work in harmony because of the work time you have with polyurea. So we were discussing that epoxy has a bit more of a work time. That's why you might see some businesses work with just one person. But here we're watching two technicians apply it at the same time to get that even coat and to get the proper work time in, because you could do it by yourself, but you're gonna be stressed out. So if you have one person rolling, the other person spreading it, it just gives them that much more time to work the material around.
I think that's the one challenge that we have with even just the two of us. I'm the one who, you know, posting on social media and stuff, and I do my best to even try to make videos, but we get so engulfed in the work.
Right.
That I remember it, but I'm just like, you know what, I don't have time, or my hands are dirty, or I'll completely forget.
I think this is where it's cool, is because I'm that customer looking from the outside in. I don't know anything about it, but I value it and I want it and I'm getting it and I'm watching the process. So like I'm watching Jastel spread, but then Manny's already over in the corner and he's already spreading it. And it's totally technique. This is not an exact science, is it? You're just kind of going by feel and you're just watching how it's just spreading around.
Exactly.
And how it looks.
And you know, the more you do it, the better you get at it. Almost every single job, we will come across a new technique or a new way to,
like a new challenge.
Apply it and attack the job. And
yeah.
What if we do this? Maybe it won't dry as fast or what have you. We've changed up our technique so many times.
And then you'll use different techniques depending on the new situation that you're
in.
Like
situation, the size of the job. You know, obviously here we have a lot of edges, a lot of corners. The fact that the floor is heated, we attacked it differently as well.
Right. What did you, because the floor is heated, what did you do differently?
Normally we would go further along the edges with our paintbrush.
Okay.
With this, we stop a little bit short because if we go too far, it's going to end up drying on us.
Oh, okay.
And the flakes aren't going to stick.
Oh, so
it's a problem down the road, we can patch it.
But you're mindful of the cure time being affected by the heated floor.
Yeah, and you know, if we can avoid having to make those patches during the top coat, it just makes the job go smoother and quicker, and so it's easier for us.
So we can kind of compare now that we have a half and half. We can see, well, the grind, this has been prepped, so it lost a bit of its shine. It's not as glossy as before. But then we're looking at here with the flake. And that's just laying the flake. There's still a top coat that needs to go on to that as well. But so you guys can kind of see, like, you know, choose what product's best for you. I think most of you are going to go with the flake due to the durability, ability to change color. And like, just looking at it already, like, it from this distance, it already looks perfect, and he just laid it on, and I'm pretty close to it. It's not like we're doing a 15-foot rule here or anything like that. So here's a good opportunity for you guys to see. We can see here is the grind and seal. There is the polyurea as the color by itself. So that color will change depending on the flake that you change. And here it is with flake. So we were discussing that there might be a scenario where you don't want the flake. I was saying, like, maybe it's in a studio or something, but the downside to that is don't think because you're not flaking and you're just doing this, you're gonna save money. Because if you notice, we can still see imperfections. So you have to do, even though that crack is filled, you'd have to do more work or you'd have to do more coats if you want it to look perfect and be this color. It can be done, but don't do just the color because you think you're gonna save money. Do the color because there's other reasons. You just love the look or you need it for other purposes, because you can see with it laid out, we can even see the reflection because it's wet. We see the reflection of the toolboxes, but it's really reflecting that light really well. So we can see here at this stage is where they're blowing all the excess material off. So right now the guys are putting on the final coat. So is this the same process as the first coat on the base coat?
Yeah. We typically need more product for the top coat because the flakes will absorb quite a bit of the product.
So it's actually getting underneath and around the sides of everything. So I'm not sure how well this will show up on camera, but when I'm looking at it in person, seeing the coating here and the flake not coated with the top coat yet, this really starts to pop, you can guys can see. So this is why it's really worth having it done in these stages. And right here is the main reason why we want a coating like this. So we have used oil, not new. An epoxy floor will do this just fine. Even a cheap painted floor, you'll get a similar result. So the problem is with bare concrete, without any kind of treatment, even if that oil just dropped, it'll still leave a stain. What's worse is, if it sits there for a bit, it's going to soak into the concrete. And you'll have to use like kitty litter. I've shown you guys techniques where you use kitty litter and it'll soak it up. What's nice about this is it doesn't soak in. So then you can just wipe it up. Now, I would recommend that you take some brake clean to this afterwards, because this is still going to be slippery. There's still going to be a bit of an oil residue on there. Also, if you were going to start working in your shop, try to give it at least 7 days of cure time. So that's at room temperature, 21, 22 degrees Celsius. in that 7 days, that'll make sure that it really cures properly. Even here, you can see from our jack, the steel wheels have left a little bit of rust. That usually likes to stain bare concrete. You see, it just wipes right out. And here's the final test that I really don't want to do on a new floor. So we're going to take our 22 mil, drop it. I don't see any damage. Even if there was, because of how the pattern works, you're not going to notice damage nearly as much over time. Like, it will get broken depending on how hard you are. Like, give it 10 years in a commercial shop, you're probably going to see a little bit of wear. It really just depends on the environment. In a shop like ours, where it's more of a hobby shop than anything, this is going to last indefinitely. And here is the final result. So it looks awesome. Pretty standard what you'd notice if you ever look at other pictures or videos of a garage floor with flake in it. So what I really like about this particular one, this is what they call domino. So it's predominantly gray, white, and black would be the next color. So it's like 50% gray and white, and then black would be the other 50%. So what I like about this is, compared to our old setup, it reflects light a lot more. Now, granted, I usually have my project truck sitting here, so it's gonna absorb light. There's no vehicles in here, so it's directly off the floor. So yes, I'll say that will make it brighter, but you can see, you don't see any imperfections. It's all masked away, and it's gonna be more durable. And also, you can feel much more texture in it. So in the winter time, when the vehicles, when the snow melts off the vehicles and the floor is really wet, we're gonna have significantly more traction. It's a lot safer in here for everyone. So what do you guys think? Would you do this to your floor? Like I said, I tried grind and seal before, I liked it. For my needs though, I like this a lot more. Comment below, I'd like to know.